Greetings. In this video, we'd like to share with you some of our work on collaborative approaches to evaluation. Specifically, we have an evidence-based set of principles that we've developed. I'm going to give you the background and rationale for why we wanted to develop these principles, but we're also going to share with you the methodology we used in order to put the principles together. Finally, we're going to describe the principles and walk through them quickly, and we'll end up with some thoughts about how we can use and apply the principles and where we go from here.
Our motivation for this work came from our interest in the family of models and frameworks using collaborative approaches. Each one of these provides a unique and important contribution to thinking about conducting evaluation. In exploring all these frameworks, what is common is the use of a collaborative approach. By this we mean an approach where evaluators work with program community members to jointly conduct the evaluation and produce knowledge for decision making.
Recently, there's been interest in differentiating among various approaches with particular identities. But given that context is key and often quite volatile, it makes a lot more sense to focus on a set of overarching principles.
Another contribution that we've observed in the field is interest in the development of visual representation of evaluation theory. We think that this is a really important approach on many levels. Participatory evaluation, including practical and transformative approaches, have been included in this. An issue for us about that is that it can make the process seem a lot more rigid and than it really is intended to be. It's much more dynamic and fluid.
There are three reasons for collaborative approaches: pragmatic, social justice, and getting at a deeper understanding of the program. All three of these need to be in balance. We also talk about two streams: the practical, which comes out of the focus on use in North America, and transformative, which emerges from philosophers in Latin America, Africa, and India.
A while ago, we developed a framework that shows three fundamental dimensions of form or process in collaborative approaches to evaluation. The first of these has to do with technical decision-making and the control over it. Is it the evaluators on the one hand or the stakeholders on the other? The next has to do with diversity among the stakeholders involved. Is it a large, diverse group, or is it a narrow, well-defined group? And finally, we have depth of participation. To what extent are stakeholders involved in actually doing the evaluation? Is it shallow involvement, or is it really deep involvement? We think that all three of these helped us to define what collaborative approaches look like in practice.
In our experience, entry into an evaluation is usually a response to a call from a member of the program community. In responding to this call, evaluators typically begin by listening to needs and learning about the context where the evaluation will take place. In doing this, we also start to tease out which purpose or purposes are motivating the call and what form the evaluation will take. In all cases, the one constant is that context will shape the evaluation process.
We wanted to generate a set of evidence-based principles to guide collaborative approaches that is grounded in the experience of practicing evaluators. We used mixed method to gather our data, and the design involved quantitative ratings and qualitative descriptions of actual collaborative projects. But the principles were mainly derived from qualitative responses to the open-ended questions about project success or lack of it. In the design, the order of the question sets, successful, less than successful, was randomized to counterbalance for the possible response set bias. And our specific focus, of course, was on the factors or reasons why projects were successful or not.
The principles emerged from a four-year project. The first two were pilot phases that involved think tanks at AEA that explored the interest in the project. But phase three, the data collection phase, which involved an online survey, was the main phase of the project, of which 320 evaluators participated. Finally, we had a validation phase and had 58 evaluators provide feedback on the draft principles. The qualitative data were coded using in vivo software and analyzed using conventional inductive techniques. Emerging themes were identified, which we named contributing factors. These were those who contributed to and differentiated successful and less successful collaborative inquiry. Through interpretation and deliberation, the team worked together to sort through the contributing factors into clusters, which we then used to underwrite the naming of each principle.
This figure represents the configuration of the eight principles that comprise our final set. What's interesting about this configuration is the principles are to be taken as a set, not to be used as a pick and choose proposition. Secondly, the principles are interconnected, they're overlapping. Thirdly, the principles will apply differently in different contexts, they'll be weighted differently. And finally, the principles are not in any particular sequential order. There may be a loose ordering to them, but they're not expected to be in any given stepwise order.
This first principle emphasizes the importance of really understanding why there's a need for this approach and whether the approach is congruent with the purpose. In the next principle, the emphasis is on building meaningful and quality working relationships between evaluators and program stakeholders, which would include such things as open and frequent communication and valuing prior relevant experiences.
A shared understanding of the program needs to be held not only between the evaluation stakeholder and the evaluator, but within the program community itself. It may be helpful to generate this understanding through an investigation of the program logic. When we promote participatory processes, we are taking responsibility for facilitating a level of engagement, deliberation, and reflection necessary to meet expectations for the evaluation.
In collaborative approaches, resources is about people, and this is what you need to manage well. Also, the quality of evaluation is very important, and in collaborative approaches, evaluator can help with this to maintain the professional standards of evaluation practice.
This principle suggests that there is a role for integrating evaluation into an organizational culture. Here we define use broadly, beyond decision-making, to include learning and capacity building.
In thinking about the use and application of this set of principles, four possibilities come to mind. The first is they can be used to guide collaborative approaches to evaluation. Secondly, they can be used to analyze retrospectively projects that have already finished. Thirdly, they can be used to help inform professional development for evaluators. Finally, they could be used as a conceptual framework to guide ongoing inquiry on collaborative approaches to evaluation.
Do these principles work well with specific evaluation frameworks? Are they more relevant for those who already have a deep understanding of evaluation practice? Do they offer useful guidance in cross-cultural settings? These questions demonstrate how much more there is to understand about the use of collaborative approaches. For example, we are only beginning to learn whether our partners in the various program communities will identify these same principles and contributing factors as relevant for successful evaluation.
We understand these principles to be dynamic and requiring review and revision over time. To that end, we'd like to promote a set of field studies to test them out in practice. And we'd like to invite you to participate in the field studies. Please stay tuned for information, and thanks for listening.